Hello friends, I am Kiran Chand Tiwari. I welcome you to the reading section. Here I recommend to you the top 5 motivational and inspirational books every child of 15 years must read. Francis Bacon says, some books are to be tasted, some others to be swallowed, and some few to be chewed and digested. These 5 books fall in the category to be chewed and digested, so worthy of reading. Now, which is the audience for this course? Children of the age group 15 to 18, children preparing for competitive exams, children lacking self-confidence, children unable to choose their career, children depressed after having tasted failure, and any child above the age group wishing 100% success in his life must read these books. What is the importance of reading motivational and inspirational books at teenage? Being an adolescent, you should definitely read some books that will shape your journey of life. Books that can build immense inner strength and give you the courage to pursue your dreams. I would recommend you these 5 books that will impact your thinking and change your life positively. At the teenage, children usually doubt their skills and capabilities, but these books will definitely transform you. You should be an enthusiastic reader. Take pain to become a good reader that will surely transform your life and you will be all smiles throughout your life. Books are the best companions. You cannot find a better way to spend your time than reading good books. Excuses will lead you nowhere. So always try to spare some time from your busy schedule to read some good books and you will have a fulfilled life. The first book I have chosen for you is The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho. It's a short tale to teach a moral lesson to follow your dreams. Where there is a will, there is a way has been proved through this fable. The whole universe will come to your aid and ensure your success if you follow your dreams. The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho is one of the best-selling books in history. The story of Santiago, the shepherd boy on a journey to realize his personal legend, has inspired people all over the world to live their dreams. Now, in the subsequent slides, you will find 10 popular passages and lessons that you get from this book to apply to your life. The first lesson that you get is, fear is bigger obstacle than the obstacle itself. Tell your heart that the fear of suffering is worse than the suffering itself, and that no heart has ever suffered when it goes in search of its dreams, because every second of the search is a second encounter with God and with eternity. Any new pursuit requires entering uncharted territory. That's scary, but with any great risk comes great reward. The experiences you gain in pursuing your dream will make it all worthwhile. What is true will always endure. If what one finds is made of pure matter, it will never spoil. Truth cannot be veiled by smoke and mirrors. It will always stand firm. When you are searching for your right decision, it will be the one that withstands the test of time and wait for scrutiny. Break the monotony. When each day is the same as the next, it's because people fail to recognize the good things that happen in their lives. Every day that the sun rises, gratitude is the practice of finding that good in each day. Life can easily become stagnant, mundane, and monotonous, but that changes depending on what we choose to see. There is always a silver lining if you look for it. Embrace the present, because I don't live in either my past or my future. I am interested only in the present. If you can concentrate always on the present, you will be a happy man. There is no point dwelling on the past and letting it define you. nor getting lost and anxious about the future. But in the present moment, you are in the field of possibility. How you engage with the present moment will direct your life. Your success has a ripple effect. That's what alchemists do. They show that when we strive to become better, then we are, everything around us becomes better too. Growth, change, and evolution are weaved into a fabric of reality. Becoming a better version of yourself creates a ripple effect that benefits everything around you, your lifestyle, your family, your friends, your community. Make the decision. When someone makes a decision, he is really diving into a strong current that will carry him to places he has never dreamed of when he first made the decision. It's easy to get overwhelmed by the unknowns and finer details of your dreams. Action will flow out of having confidence in your decision. Sitting on the fence will get you nowhere. Be unrealistic. I see the world in terms of what I would like to see happen, not what actually does. Some of the greatest inventions would not have happened if people chose to accept the world as it is. Great achievements and innovations begin with a mindset that ignores the impossible. Keep getting back up. The secret of life, though, is to fall 7 times and to get up 8 times. Because the 8th time could be your breakthrough. Some of the greatest novels in history were published after receiving hundreds of rejections. Thankfully, those authors never gave up. Focus on your journey. If someone isn't what others want him to be, the others become angry. Everyone seems to have a clear idea of how other people should lead their lives, but none about his or her own. It's easy to be influenced by others, but you will be miserable if you end up living someone else's life. There is nothing wrong with taking advice and learning from others, but make sure that it aligns with your desires and passions. Always take action. There is only one way to learn, it's through action. You can study, read, and listen until you turn blue in the face, but the full experience is when you take the action and let the rubber meet the road. Once you are done aiming, pull the trigger. So, in a nutshell, if you follow your dreams with all your efforts, success will be yours. Thank you. This is the end of book one. So now we come to the second book, that is Wings of Fire, written by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam is a renowned Indian scientist who became the 11th president of India from 2002 to 2007. He is well known across India and the world and is a recipient of 3 highest civilian awards of India, Padma Bhushan, Padma Vibhushan and Bharat Ratna. Wings of Fire is an autobiography of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam written jointly by Abdul Kalam and Arun Tiwari. It covers the life of Abdul Kalam before he became President of India. The book covers early life of Abdul Kalam and his work in Indian space research and missile programs. It is a story of a boy from a humble background who became the key player in India's space research and missile programs and became the President of India. The initial chapters of The Wings of Fire gives a vivid picture of India from 1930 to 1950. Kalam was born in Rameshwaram, a religious town in Tamil Nadu. The initial chapter provides glimpses of religious harmony which existed before partition of India. Kalam in younger years wanted to become an Air Force pilot, but he could not clear the interview. He met Swami Sivananda after his rejection from Air Force Selection Board, and Swamiji advised him in very prophetic words. Shivananda says, accept your destiny and go ahead with your life. You are not destined to become an Air Force pilot. What you are destined to become is not revealed now, but it is predetermined. Forget the failure, as it was essential to lead you to your destined path. Search instead for the true purpose of your existence. Become one with yourself, my son. Surrender yourself to the wish of God. How Kalam started his career in aeronautical development establishment and was involved in the design of a hovercraft is described in this book. Later, he moved to Indian Space Research Organization, which was the brainchild of Vikram Sarabhai. In 1963, Kalam went to NASA facility in Maryland, USA, as part of a training program on sounding rocket launching techniques. There he came across a painting which depicted Tipu Sultan's rocket warfare against the Britishers and was much impressed. The book covers a lot of behind-the-scene information and technical details about India's satellite and missile programs SLV-3, Prithvi, Agni, Trishul, Akash and Nag. Space and missile programs are huge, complex projects, and managing them is extremely challenging. The book does not give glimpses of the participatory management technique adopted by Kalam, but at the same time, it doesn't go into details. Kalam is a poet too, and is a huge fan of poems. The book contains many of his own poems and his favorite poems. Here is an example. Do not look at Agni as an entity directed upward. Do deter the ominous or exhibit your might. It is fire in the heart of an Indian. Do not even give it the form of a missile as it clings to the burning pride of this nation and thus is bright. One of the things that stands out throughout this book is Kalam's positive thinking. In the book, he rarely mentions anything about lethargy, corruption of bureaucracy or politicians. The secret of his success seems to be his ability to ignore negative things around him. The book also gives a clue to his popularity in India. Kalam was a simple, secular, inspiring humanitarian. The final words from Kalam. To succeed in your mission, you must have single-minded devotion to your goal. How to get success or riches has been very nicely described in this book. There is no quick way to success or riches, but you can still get there one step at a time. Means you have to continuously put your efforts to reach to your goal. The gist of this book is, to succeed in your mission, you must have single-minded devotion to your goal. The learning from this book, there may be obstacles at your feet, but it will keep you, your eyes and mind totally focused on your goal. And certainly, if you are focused on your goal, you will be getting through your dreams and reaching your goal. Thank you. This is the end of book 2. Now we come to the third book, that is The Ignited Minds, again by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. Dr. Kalam has dedicated Ignited Minds to an intermediate child named Snehal Thakkar, whom he met at his school, and while talking to the students, a question has come up: who is our enemy? Kalam recalled that many answers came up, But the answer on which all agreed came from her: our enemy is poverty. It is the root cause of our problems and should be the object of our fight, not our own. This small book contains dynamic and original ideas. It examines attitudes afflicting the Indians and present prescriptions for the rapid growth of India to enable the country to emerge as a developed country. The Dream and Masses from Kalam. Spirituality must be integrated with education. Self-realization is the focus. Each one of us must be aware of our higher self. We should ignite our dormant inner energy and let it guide our lives. The radiance of such minds embarked on constructive endeavor will bring peace, prosperity, and bliss to the nation. Give us a role model. A nation's wealth is the young generation of the country. When they grow up, who can be the role models? Mother, father, and elementary school teachers play a very important part as role models. When the child grows up, the role models will be national leaders of quality and integrity. In every field, including politics, the sciences, technology, and industry. Visionary leaders and scientists. Vision ignites the minds. India needs visionaries of the stature of J.R.D. Tata, Vikram Sarabhai, Satish Dhawan, and Dr. Varghese Kurian. These type of visionaries can involve an entire generation in mission-driven programs which benefit the country as a whole. You must build on the resources represented by our young professionals and by our nation's farmers. Without their involvement, we cannot succeed. With their involvement, we can never fail. Learning from saints and seers. We survived as a nation the onslaught of invaders and numbing effect of colonialism. We have also learned to adjust to the rifts and divisions in our own society. In the process of all the adjustment, we also lowered our aims and expectations. Our spiritual wisdom has been our strength. We must regain our broad outlook and draw upon our heritage and wisdom to enrich our lives. We need to homegrow our own model of development based on our inherent strengths. Patriotism beyond politics and religion. There are success stories among failures. There is hope among chaos, promise among problems. We are 1 billion people with multiple faiths and ideologies. The absence of a national vision makes us vulnerable. There is need to reinforce this seam and amalgamate us into one national forum. The Knowledge Society. Ancient India was a knowledge society that contributed a great deal to the civilization. We need to recover that status and become a knowledgeable power. We must learn from our mistakes to achieve a better standard of life. A developed India will supplement a spirit of defeat with the spirit of victory. Getting the forces together. We need to adapt the implementation of our programs and policies into a mission mode to succeed. Progress cannot be swift and far-reaching if the path is full of potholes. The abundant national resources, human and material, remain to be fully utilized. Building a new state, the way to development is through purposeful activity. The young have to be guided properly so that their lives find a proper direction and their creativity is allowed to flower. To facilitate this, certain educational reforms must be initiated. The mindset must change. Showing willingness to take pragmatic risks Success will certainly follow. To my countrymen, we need to realize that missions are always bigger than organizations, just as organizations are always bigger than the individuals who run them. Missions need effort, and the mind provides the purpose. We need a vision that is shared by the entire nation. No ideology is above the security and prosperity of our country. No agenda is more important than harmony among the people. Our freedom did not come as a gift. The whole country struggled for decades to achieve the first vision of independence, so we have to protect it. In conclusion, we can say this book contains the following. Nations consist of people, and with their effort, a nation can accomplish all it could ever want. Motivating India's youth especially is the central theme of Ignited Minds. Igniting Minds is all about breaking away from the forces that would prefer selling cheap labor and raw materials and providing a large market for goods and services of other nations. It is about developing that conviction in ourselves and discarding the things that holds us back. Dr. Kalam writes, embedded the thought, nation is bigger than the individual, in the minds of the leaders and people. And when they recite this, I see the developed India. Finally, we can conclude by saying that the beauty of this lies in the fact that while emphasizing on the technological development of nation to make India stand in the elite group of developed nations, the author also drew attention on social and cultural aspect. The author mentioned how spiritual education along with knowledge can create wonders. The book talks about how one should integrate our cultural and social values and ethics with modern thinking. Enthusiasm of youth. This integration will produce potential leaders, role models for tomorrow, which will have integrity, respect, and the thought of nation comes first, embedded in their hearts and minds. Thank you. That's the end of this book 3. Now coming to book 4. Power of Your Subconscious Mind by Dr. Joseph Murphy. Joseph says, you receive answers to prayers because of mental acceptance about what you pray. Dr. Joseph Murphy studied Eastern religion and was minister at the Los Angeles branch of the Church of Divine Science for 28 years. Murphy felt that there were secrets he had found concerning the subconscious that were beyond time and culture, and that should find a wider audience. Hence, he wrote this book. Murphy was influenced by Ernest Holmes and Emmett Fox, both well-known writers on New Thought principles, but this academic background was in Eastern religion. He spent many years in India and was an Andhra research fellow at the University of India. He has given some pictorial description also about the effect of prayer and has proved that scientifically how the prayers affect our brain. Now the highlights of this book are, the first one point is, you receive answers to prayer because of mental acceptance about what you pray. Murphy proposes that your religion affiliation is not what makes prayer effective. Rather, it is based on your ability and willingness to accept what you pray. It makes sense that whatever you can accept on a conscious level has to be accepted by your subconscious as well. Another statement that expands on this idea is this one: the subconscious mind is subject to the conscious mind. What Murphy is saying is that you can train your subconscious mind to believe what you can accept on a conscious level. The second point is, your subconscious mind has the answer to all your problems. This statement makes perfect sense if you don't have any problems with the idea that your subconscious mind is equal to God. Even if not for that, though it speaks to the power of the subconscious mind, you don't need to go looking outside for the answers you seek. Murphy is saying you can look inside and pose questions to your subconscious. The answer may not come immediately, but your mind is always working on problems you submit to it, even when you are doing other things, and it will eventually present to you a workable solution. The third point, which has been discussed in this book, is faith is the only universal healing principle operating through everybody. He says, I believe the implication here is that faith is created by accessing and harnessing the power of our subconscious minds. Illness, physical ailments, and even traumatic experiences can be healed by repeatedly submitting thoughts of healing to our subconscious minds. Can we be healed by any other means? According to Murphy, no. Faith is the universal healing principle. Of course, I don't think he would discount the importance of medicine or other orthodox cures, but I have to guess that in this case he is referring to instances of healing that have occurred in so-called healing service, churches or religious gatherings. The fourth point that has been covered in this book is, if a prayer is answered, it is answered scientifically. What Murphy is suggesting is that there is a formula to prayers that are answered. He explains that science means knowledge that is coordinated, arranged, and systematized. So the idea here is that we can cooperate with our subconscious minds to see more of our prayers answered. If anything, the entire book sheds light on how little attention and thought we give to our subconscious minds and what fantastic tools they are in helping us to achieve ends that we desire to see in our lives. The fourth important point is, don't compel your subconscious mind to accept your idea by willpower. Although Murphy does talk about presenting positive thoughts and images to our subconscious minds, he is also quick to caution us that we can't force things. Our willpower is limited and it continues to decrease and diminish throughout the day. Can you imagine how tiring it would be to force yourself to think the same things and visualize the same images all day long? I think the idea is that we can plant seeds and nurture them, but we shouldn't be constantly uncovering the soil to see how our seeds are doing. We have to keep pulling the weeds and watering the seeds. And while that way, it may require a daily investment, it shouldn't take more than a couple of minutes. The next point covered is, the world you live in is determined by what goes in your mind. Whether or not you subscribe to Murphy's theology, I think this is something we can all agree on. What goes into mind is hugely important. If you choose poorly, you will assimilate bad attitudes, behaviors, and thoughts. If you choose well, you will begin to see positive changes within yourself. What world you want to live in? Have you thought about it? If you aren't sure what you want to achieve in your lifetime, it makes it much harder to select input that will assist you on your journey. If you are fully in alignment with your objectives, choosing the right input becomes much easier. In Joseph Murphy had studied Eastern religion and was minister at the Los Angeles branch of the Church of Divine Science for 28 years. Murphy felt that there were secrets he had found concerning the subconscious that were beyond time and culture and that should find a wider audience. Murphy was influenced by Ernest Holmes and Emmett Fox, both well-known writers on New Thought principles, but his academic background was in Eastern religion. He spent many years in India and was a research scholar at Andhra University of India. So this book ultimately contributes by unleashing the power of prayer in your life, how the prayers affect your life and how they benefit you. Thank you. So this is the end of the fourth book. Now we come to the last book, that is the fifth book, is You Can Win by Shiv Khera. This book is a construction manual for success. Mr. Shiv Khera is the founder of Qualified Learning Systems Inc. USA, an author, educator, business consultant, and successful entrepreneur. The mission of this book, wants you to create an action plan for your rest of your life. And what are these action plans? The first one is what you want to achieve. The second one, how you expect to achieve it. And finally, when you plan to achieve it. The whole book is divided into 8 chapters. And these are briefly described here as importance of attitude, success, motivation, self-esteem, interpersonal skills, subconscious mind and habits, goal setting, value and visions. After going through this book, you will find that you have become totally positive and you are experiencing the win-win position in your life. The author's perception is that when he asks the business owners from the world if there was one thing that you would like to see change that would make your organization more productive, what would it be? They all said attitude. So he says 85% of time a person gets a promotion at the work due to attitude and 15% of the time due to what they know about their work. So attitude has a great influence and effect on your career and it greatly affects your journey of life. So you should always develop positive attitude in your life that has been broadly described in this book through these 8 chapters which I have mentioned here, that is importance of attitude, success, motivation, self-esteem, interpersonal skills, subconscious mind and habits, goal setting, value and visions. Thank you. This is the end of book 5. If you go through these books, 5 books, I think you will be a totally changed personality. You will find the difference in you. People around you will experience the difference in you, the change in you, your parents, your teachers, Everyone around will appreciate you for your dynamic approach to your life after reading these five books. Thank you. Have a nice time.